Welcome to the world's first truly international television show, circling the globe by satellite link to bring everything that happens anytime, anywhere into the living rooms of the whole planet's population, except for viewers in Scotland who have their own program. Apparently, President George Bush of the USA is a big fan of ours and wants to pay us a small compliment, so I'm going over to Washington by satellite telephone. Can you hear me, George?
All right, Jim.
He always calls me Jim. George, what do you think of our little show?
I think what you're doing is significant and important, and I think it'll send a great signal to all of us wherever we may be.
Well, George, I always enjoy our little chats, but we have a show to do here, so would you mind getting off the line?
Okay. Good luck.
Thank you, George Bush. Also tonight, in a week when it is revealed that the Duchess of York went out twice with Sylvester Stallone, Sly tells us, "She made me feel completely relaxed." In a week when Prince Charles says that painting keeps him sane, another famous painter tells us, "Yes, I haven't talked to a tree in weeks." In a week when the names of Princess Anne and Luciano Pavarotti are linked, each of Anne's horses tells the other, "If it goes any further, you get him." And now, the world news headlines. Search continues for Foreign Secretary's teeth. Chancellor Cole teaches dog new trick. Fergie remembers tender moment with Sylvester Stallone. My mother-in-law sold my chair, says Prince. Rolling Stones join Labour campaign. And now, the world news in brief. It was learned recently that Prince Edward would like to join the BBC. Tonight, we can reveal that he already has. He's joined the Saturday Night Clive team, and from now on, he'll play a crucial role in the production of this program. Thanks, Ed. And now, the world news in depth. Pollsters were amazed this week by the sudden surge in Prime Minister John Major's perceived sex appeal. Even the French are suddenly saying that Mr. Major is sexy. We can exclusively reveal the reason why. John Major has just returned by Concorde from a night of ecstasy in Acapulco with Madonna. As he told our reporter at Heathrow, he's come back a man transformed, reckless, passionate, sensual, with the piercingly erotic episode burning in his memory.
I think it was a very valuable experience.
And by satellite from Los Angeles, how would Madonna sum up this night of unbridled passion?
A really great learning experience.
This week, the polls revealed that Labour Party leader Neil Kinnock's personal rating is rock bottom. To fight back, Neil Kinnock plans to launch a television commercial about himself, created by Chariots of Fire director Hugh Hudson. The commercial goes to air next week, but we have an exclusive preview. They never told you the truth about Neil Kinnock. They never told you that he speaks 16 languages and composes remarkably delicate piano sonatas for a man who gives so much time to designing supersonic aircraft. They never told you that women find him so attractive, he has to beat them off with a rolled-up newspaper. They never told you about his uncanny gift of inspiring trust and affection in the young. They never told you that in his work as a nuclear scientist, he was the first to create an atomic explosion in his own bathwater. They never told you that as a part-time, fully trained SAS commando, he drives his own tank to Tesco's on a Saturday morning. They never told you that he is a man who can talk to dumb animals as if they were Labour Party voters, and vice versa. They never told you that Neil Kinnock was born to be Prime Minister, but now the British people are telling him, Neil, the job is yours.
I think that's absolutely ridiculous.
It's been announced that one of Britain's modern transport triumphs, the M25 motorway, is to be improved once again. The existing three lanes will be narrowed to provide four lanes, but there won't be any lowering of safety standards as long as cars are driven correctly. This week, regular users of the M25 were already in training to use the new lanes. One driver said, after spending 12 years of my life in a jam within sight of the M4 interchange, it's going to be a pleasure sharing the new lanes with Oliver Reed, Alex Higgins, George Best, and the Princess of Wales. World politics. And today, the people of the Philippines are struggling with all the problems of democracy. But once, they led a more orderly existence under the rule of Ferdinand Marcos. After troublemakers alleged that he looked after the economy by exporting most of it to Switzerland, Ferdinand and his lovely wife, Imelda, were encouraged by their grateful people to take early retirement abroad, where Ferdinand died without having time to clear his name. But Imelda still bravely carries the Marcos banner. Put on trial in New York for the alleged crime of having enough high-heeled shoes for the whole Filipino army, she was triumphantly acquitted. But now comes the stunning news that she's going back to the Philippines, and it could happen very soon. Her bags are already packed, but at this moment, she's standing by in New York, ready to talk to us by satellite about the upcoming and possibly final chapter in her amazing life story. Can you hear me, Imelda Marcos?
Yes, I can hear you, Mr. James.
Mrs. Marcos, your sworn enemies are in power in the Philippines. Why on earth are you going back?
Well, I have, first of all, to fulfill a filial and sacred obligation to bury the remains of my late husband in our home country. And also, at the same time, I have to face a trial in the Philippines for historical reasons and for the truth to prevail in my country, since we had been so maligned during the Aquino administration. We feel that we must also face trial during her time, her term, and her turf.
What do you think you have to offer the people of the Philippines now?
One of the things that I carry with me now that I think will be most useful in our country and for our people is my intense sensitivity to pain, to suffering, deprivation, and humiliation.
This is a delicate question, but how are you going to take your late husband home? Is he embalmed?
Well, he has, yes, and preserve modern technology has been very much in advance. And my only problem would be if they took the remains of my late husband to a communal grave and bury him underground in a foreign country.
When your husband was still in power and Cory Aquino's husband came back to the Philippines, he never even made it out of the airport. Aren't you afraid that the same thing might happen to you? You might never get as far as the trial?
Maybe so, but if one is afraid to go home, then one is afraid to go anywhere else.
A lot of people have said that your husband had something to do with the death of Mrs. Aquino's husband. Is there any truth in that?
A brilliant man like the late President Marcos would never have even thought of it.
Mrs. Marcos, if you don't have the $10 billion that Mrs. Aquino says you stole from the Filipino people, where is it?
I really do not know what they're talking about because they've been looking for that for the last almost 6 years. And in fact, in the 20 years that Marcos was president, wherein he never even received a single cent as a salary for as president. And the total income then was about 500 billion pesos.
Mrs. Marcos, the whole world is fascinated with your shoes. Was it really necessary to have 3,500 pairs?
Well, first of all, I would like to say that when you open anybody's closet, you find shoes. Thanks God, closet, they found shoes and not skeletons. Plus the fact that as first lady of a developing country wherein we were exporting shoes, textile, and garment, it was our responsibility to promote our exports.
Where are those shoes now that were in the closet?
Well, it is in Mrs. Aquino's keep.
Do you think they fit her?
Well, I said the last time because I read in one of the papers that we were of the same size, but she denied this. She said it's a different size.
How many pairs of shoes do you have now?
I really wouldn't know. Definitely much less than what I had.
You used to sing a great deal before these sad events. Do you still sing?
Well, all Filipinos sing. We are somewhat like Italians. We love to sing. After all, music is still the language of the soul.
Mrs. Marcos, how do you think history will judge you?
Well, I know since I was some kind of a history major in college, I know that history will judge you not for what people say or write about you, it is what you have done. And I think history will be very generous to the Marcoses, both President Marcos and Imelda Marcos.
Mrs. Marcos, I'll be watching what happens next with the same fascination with which I've listened to you tonight. Thank you very much, Imelda Marcos. In Britain, Blind Date continues to be an enormous hit show. But it was born in Australia 20 years ago, when Australian television was still black and white, and young Australian men were wearing flared trousers, flared hair, flared everything. In those days, Australian presenters had to have American accents, but the contestants were only required to be alive. With that. In this excerpt, three unknown young men are competing for the hand of an unknown young woman. See if you can guess which one will be lucky and which one should be on life support.
Contestant number one is Stephen Wynn. He's a storeman and enjoys basketball and stamp collecting. Welcome, Stephen. Contestant number two is Chris Picora. He's an apprentice hairdresser and he likes playing the drums and wrestling. Welcome to Blind Date, Chris. A lot of fans in tonight. Contestant number three is Alan McNamara, and he's an apprentice diesel mechanic and enjoys playing the drums, football, and girls. Welcome, Alan. Now, our mystery guest has been waiting off the stage with earphones on and has not heard my introduction to any of the contestants, so let's meet her right now.
Hey, Bobby, our mystery guest on Blind Night is the very beautiful photographic model, Pam Britt.
Hi, and welcome, mystery guest. We just want you to sit down, relax, choose the answers that you like. We've got three very anxious contestants over here all down to get on with the game, so let's do that right now. Contestant number three, do you have any ambition to travel overseas?
Yes, I'd like to go to Switzerland.
Number two, where would you like to go?
I'd like to study new hairstyles and fashion and look around.
Do you have any ambition?
Europe.
All over Europe. And number one?
I'd like to go to New Zealand and see Tasmania as well.
Mystery guest, which one of those would you choose?
I'd like to go to Switzerland, so I'd say number one.
Well, that would be number three in that case, because he was the first one to answer, so congratulations, number three. And number one again. Let's go back. Here's your first question. Do you understand people who like to be alone?
Yes, I do, because sometimes I like to be alone myself.
And number two?
Sort of. A lot of them just like being alone or... Yeah, it's lonesome.
And number three?
Yes, maybe because they're upset and they want to be with their problems.
Which one of those answers would you choose, mystery guest?
I'd have to say number one, I think.
Number one, congratulations. You're doing well. That's your second symbol. And from here in, we go into a two-part question. And you either write down A or B. Now, here's the question. What's your favorite meal? A, roast beef, B, fish and chips. roast beef, or B, fish and chips. A or B. All right, if you're finished writing it down, we'll ask the question once more for the mystery guest. What's your favorite meal? A, roast beef, or B, fish and chips?
I'd say roast beef.
Roast beef, so we're looking for an A. So again, we'll go over to contestant number three. Let's see what you got. Congratulations, that's your third one, so you still got a good chance. Contestant number two, that's another symbol for you. Congratulations. Now, if you got an A, let's see if he's got it, and he's won it. That's the fourth symbol. Congratulations. Stephen Wynn, would you step forward right now and meet your blind date, Pam Britt. After you kiss, you just look away. What do you think? You happy with your choice?
Yeah.
Good-looking guy?
Yeah.
How about you, Steve?
Yeah, fine.
Fine? Just, yeah, that's it. Beautiful. Good. Well, Pam is one of the top models in Australia. Yeah. And you're doing very well for yourself over here, aren't you?
Yeah.
And all that. It's beautiful. So we're going to get Johnny right now to tell us where you're going out on your date.
Hey, Bobby, what a night they're going to have. Pam and Steve are going to a swingy evening at Peanuts Gallery. Peanuts is a great food. You can dance and enjoy yourself in a great atmosphere. The perfect place for your blind date. Also, we have a hairdryer for you, too, called Max. Next, so you look your best in the night out, we've got a $50 voucher from Walsh's Menswear Store. You can choose from an extensive range of menswear by Australia's top fashion designers. And, of course, it comes to you from Walsh's.
20 years of embarrassment later, the presentation is glossier, but they're down to their last gimmick. The presenter, Greg Evans, now sounds like an Australian-Australian instead of an American-Australian, but this time three girls are fighting for one guy.
On Blind Date!
Welcome to Blind Date! And now, here's the star of the show, Greg Evans!
Love, I guess, transcends all barriers, doesn't it, and age groups as well.
Yes.
But tonight?
We've got a few littlies, haven't we?
Littlies, tiny ones that we've never had before, and they're out the back now, and they're as cute as anything. Please tell us about the first three girls,
Nikki.
Okay,
we've got a few new little ones. Our first contestant is mad about animals, especially soft, fluffy ones. Please say hi to Kate Keeney. Our next contestant loves beautiful butterflies and recently lost a tooth. Please say hello to Emily Rummy. And our last contestant is looking forward to her trip to Disneyland. Please say hello to Sarah Downs.
They are sensational.
They're gorgeous.
Right, Greg, our first single tonight is the answer to Georgie Porgy. The girls went crying over him. Welcome, Todd Dennis.
Oh, come down, Todd. How are you, Todd?
Good.
That's the boy. You got a girlfriend?
Nah.
You want a girlfriend?
Very nice.
Take a seat, please, Todd, and good luck to you tonight, and I wish you all the very best. Please ask your first question now, Todd.
Number one, I hate mashed potatoes. What food do you hate that your parents make you eat?
Good boy, Todd.
Broccoli, because it's horrible.
Number one hates eating broccoli. She hates eating it because it's terrible. Keep going, Todd.
What food do you hate? Number two.
Number two.
Pumpkin, especially pumpkin soup.
Don't like the taste of pumpkin soup. Righto, and Todd, to number three now.
And number three.
Same question, really, Todd. What food do you just like your parents make you?
What food do you hate?
Yeah.
Peas because they taste horrible.
Peas because they taste horrible. Number one, two, or three, Todd? That's a fair enough statement.
Two.
Number two! Has got the date with Todd! Congratulations, number two. Todd, step down, please, mate. There you go. Come over here. because what I want you to do is meet the two ladies, the two young girls that you didn't choose. Firstly, contestant number one. Come across, please. She dreams of lollies and she likes to do handstands. Say hello to Sarah Downs. Come over here, Sarah. Come over here, Sarah, and do you want to give him a kiss or anything?
No.
I didn't think you would. There you go, Sarah. Well, shake hands or something. That's the shot. Would you like to go and wait on the couch, Sarah? Thanks very much, Sarah. All right, number three. Come across, please, number three. This little lady likes jazz dancing. Kate Teeny. Hello, Kate. This is Todd.
Hi.
Hello, Kate. Good on you, Kate. See you later. Oh, I'm so sorry. So sorry. Gee, I wish you could have picked all of them, Todd. Time for you to meet the person you did choose, Todd. On the other side of the screen is contestant number two, the person you chose. She wants to grow up to be a dress designer, and she wants to be a ballet dancer as well. Todd Dennis, please meet Emily Roaming. Around her, Todd. You have this sudden desire to give her a hug, Todd? You're the first one on the show that's never wanted to do that, Todd. Would you like to shake hands with her, Todd?
Yeah.
Yeah, go on, you can shake hands. Todd and Emily, definitely the two youngest. Oh, I can see this is going to be a fun date for you two, because guess what? We're sending you to McDonald's!
At any given moment of any given day, an episode of Star Trek is on screen somewhere in the universe, being watched by countless fervent Trekkies, some with their eyes on stalks, some with a hand growing out of the top of their heads, each of them passionate admirers of the first and, for many of us, the only commander of the Starship Enterprise, Captain James T. Kirk, as played by William Shatner.
The Enterprise is dead in space, stopped cold during her pursuit of an alien raider by mysterious forces. And I have been somehow whisked off the bridge and placed on the surface of an asteroid, facing the captain of the alien ship. Weaponless, I face the creature the Metrons called a Gorn. Reptilian, like most humans, I seem to have an instinctive revulsion to reptiles. I must fight to remember that this is an intelligent, highly advanced individual. The captain of a starship like myself. Undoubtedly, a dangerously clever opponent.
It's exactly 25 years since those first episodes began their journey through time, and Mr. Shatner has gone on to play other strong men operating closer to the home galaxy. Now he lives here on Earth, if California can be so described. Somewhere in Hollywood, he's holding his personal communicator and waiting to talk to us by satellite. Can you hear me, William Shatner?
I can, and it's a great pleasure to listen to your dulcet tones.
Could I ask you where you are exactly at the moment?
Where am I exactly? I keep being asked that question. Where are you? I'm in Los Angeles in a fog. Or is it smog? And I look around me and there's a strange building behind me that's either a launching pad for a rocket or the Griffith Park Observatory. And since we're in Griffith Park, I've got to figure it's the Griffith Park Observatory.
Star Trek's hugely popular all over the world, and it's hugely popular with me. I've seen every episode.
But there's a difference between an ordinary fan like me and a real out-and-out Trekkie, isn't there?
Trekkies and the Trekkers, they have different names and different ways of wanting to be talked about, are really people with a passion. They love Star Trek, and they have fun with it. They're, for the most part, they're great sports, and some of them dress up in costumes to increase their enjoyment, but they're just people like you, Clive, who like the show. And I can send you a Klingon makeup, and maybe you'll wear it someday.
Some people think I look like that already. Does it bother you that people still say, "Beam me up, Scotty," every time you walk out of the house?
I think that's their problem. I prefer good morning, but if I walk out of the house and they say, "Beam me up, Scotty," two fingers in the eye usually is sufficient.
Let's talk about the special effects. When the Enterprise got hit by, say, a Klingon force beam, how did you work the trick? Did they shake the whole set, or did you guys have to shake yourselves?
Well, we tried, in one of the movies, we tried shaking the set. The whole set was put on a cantilever, and a large machine shook the foundation, and everything broke. I mean, television sets fell out of the lights fell down, and the actors fell down to the ground. It didn't work at all. So what we do now in the movies, as we did in the television set, is we tilt the camera. Now, I'm going to tell the cameraman to tilt his camera that way, and I'm going to show you how it works. Okay. Are you ready?
Yeah,
what's your
ready.
Name? Rick? Okay, Rick, ready? You go that way. Ready? And go.
That's dazzling. So that's how it works. Kirk seemed to have girlfriends scattered throughout the galaxy like cosmic dust. The girls he used to know were everywhere. And what did Kirk have that made him so attractive to women?
Well, they were scattered like cosmic dust, and it was really the Big Bang Theory. That was the origin of that whole theory. Things exploded from there on, and he went searching for all that dust they got away from. It was a girl in every port. I mean, a story had to have some romance, and you had a limited amount of romance from Spock, and was limited too. And I don't know. So they gave it to me.
The captain gets the girls. It's the rule of life, isn't it, really?
The rule of life had to be. And besides which, I went with a shotgun to the various writers and said, "Now look, this is the rule." So in order to keep the show alive with romance and adventure and fun, they gave me the chance to kiss a girl a week. Kiss a girl a week and get hit by a monster.
Star Trek's been running ever since everywhere, and obviously always will. Someone must have made a lot of money. How much did the actors see of it?
Somebody, let me put it this way, somebody made a lot of money. I heard a figure that Paramount Studios has grossed $1 billion on what they call the franchise. I don't know where that money is, but you notice I'm in jeans and I'm sitting in a little chair in Griffith Park being assaulted by wasps. Do you think I have any money?
Well, it's time to beam you down and for me to go all ahead warp factor one. And I want to say goodbye in Klingon, but I do not know the word for goodbye in Klingon. What is it?
Hopdir in but.
Hopdir in but? William Shatner.
You got it.
And now it's time for our BBC commercial break. A feature unique to this program, which generates tax revenue to pay the unemployment benefit of people made redundant in order to raise the efficiency of the companies producing the goods we advertise. The British love dogs. Mainly, they love Rottweilers, Pit Bull Terriers, and any other breed capable of biting a Ford Sierra in half to get at the people inside. But failing that, the British will love any dog at all, as long as it can bark, bite, and urinate on a human shoe. Here are some commercials featuring dogs.
No one should be left off your Christmas list. Not when you Shop Hill's great values.
You are looking at two closet camels. The closet camel on the right helps stop mold growing in closets. The one on the left doesn't. To prove it, we put each closet camel in a closet for 3 months. As you can see, this closet camel has absorbed dampness from the air, removed musty smells, and protected against mold. This closet camel hasn't. So, if you don't want mold in your closets, remember, this is a genuine closet camel. And this is a dog with a hump.
And now, it's time to meet our studio guest. He's one of America's most original filmmakers. He's hugely successful and rich, yet he's still ready to examine the problems of two down-and-outs when they fall in love. A moment from his new film, Life Stinks, and yes, he was the one you recognize from Blazing Saddles. He also directed The Producers. He was the 2,000-year-old man. He is eternally young, beautiful, and fragrant, with a flowing head of hair and the keen eye of the swooping hawk. Who else but Mel Brooks? Well, Imelda Marcos clearly has a fetish about footwear. Do you have any fetishes?
Yes, I do. Shall I confess it?
Yeah.
I have a fetish. I see myself making love to a beautiful woman, dressing her very slowly, taking off every stitch of her clothing, kissing her on the mouth and the eyes, kissing her all over, making love to her for hours. That's my fetish.
Well... That's not a fetish.
It's not a fetish?
No.
For Jews, that's a fetish. I'm telling you. It's never going to happen. It's a fantasy.
Well, did you ever go on a blind date when you were young?
Actually, I preferred blind dates because sighted women would refuse me quite often. But no, I don't mean any offense then. But I once went out on a blind date once with a very tall girl. And I was dancing, I was whispering sweet things into her navel, and I don't know. I wasn't making any impression at all. I took her to a door, she said, well, what's my name then was Melvin Kaminsky. She said, what's your name? I said, Melvin Kaminsky. She shut the door, that was the day. So I said, I'm gonna read. I'm gonna bone up on literature. I'm gonna be dazzling. I'm just not gonna be a fool anymore. So I read Lawrence Durrell and I read Thackeray. I read Dickens. I read morning, noon, and night. I read. Then I would go out on dates with him again. I went on another blind date. I'm having pastrami sandwich with this girl sitting across the way. She don't know what to say. I don't know what to say. And I think, yes, Thackeray. And I turn to her and I say, Lieutenant Faversham's affections to my wife were of such a nature. I was forced to deal him a lesson in manners. She said, pass the mustard. You know. And then I took her home, you know, I took her to the elevator, you know, the lift, and it was really light, bright, and I remembered from another book, A War, The Cruel Sea, Nicholas Montserrat, and I said, Faversham, the ship's ablaze like the streets of Paris, we're in a war zone, man. She said, what? You know, anyway, I didn't score with her either. I mean, it wasn't until I was 27 that I, never mind.
So what you're telling me is that dating was difficult back in Brooklyn, huh?
Oh, yes. I mean, Jews, I mean, if you...
you go out with a Jewish girl in back in Brooklyn. I mean, Jewish foreplay is 20 minutes of begging. I mean, what can I do? I mean, it's not fun, you know. I mean, if you should go out on a date and you should sit in a movie house and you should hold hands, I mean, that's a small friendship ring right there. Yeah. You've held touched flesh. Friendship, you buy a little ring. If you continue on and you take them home, you kiss in the doorway, if God forbid tongues should enter mouths, that's marriage and being buried in the same coffin. That is serious business. So, I mean, you were very careful about consummation of any kind.
Well, it's a great moment for me to have William Shatner on the program, because I'm a big, big Star Trek fan. But you yourself are a space expert.
I made a movie about it.
You made Spaceballs?
Yeah. I made Spaceballs.
You must know about relations in space.
Yeah. They just asked me to make Spaceballs, too.
Uh-huh.
They really have. I said, no, I don't make twos. I don't make twos. I may make Spaceball 3, the search for Spaceball 2. But I ain't going to make two. No twos.
Well, you're a master of foreign tongues. Do you speak any Klingon?
Just enough for bed and breakfast. I mean, just, you know, I say pour se vivre, you know. Just enough to get by.
But
I do.
You can do Swedish. You speak Swedish.
I just came from Sweden.
Yeah?
Swedish is easy. Yeah. I can speak Swedish. Yeah. Let me let you in on something. You want to know something? Yeah. Just won't go beyond this little studio. Well, I hope. They don't have a language. I'm telling you the truth. Look, pay attention. There is no Swedish language. They speak English with an accent. There's no language. I bought a cantaloupe. I gave it to this Swede. I said, you think this is good? He said, melon smelling good. They stop at a light. I hear them talking in Swedish. They stop at a light. No red, no red, no turning green. Turning green, going yet, now. They just talk English with an accent. Next in question. I'm telling you.
This I know for a fact, that you really do speak beautiful French.
Oh, yes. My French is impeccable. Yeah. You should hear me order breakfast in French. Allons au fond de la patrie. Le joie de gloire est arrivé. I'll have a rolling coffee.
Well, I know you must have been deeply moved by our dog commercials. You ever work with dogs?
I wrote a show for Sid Caesar for a long time. It was the show of shows. Sid Caesar, Imogene Coca, Carl Reiner, Howard Morris, who's in Life Stinks, by the way. He's wonderful. And we had one dog commercial that went wrong. There was this brilliant little dog. They're all terriers. And this dog went 90 miles an hour. This guy, Charlie would go, I think I forget the dog's name. I think the dog's name was Spot, yeah. Spot and Charlie. And Charlie would go, Spot, boom, like a bullet, right through. Fast, I mean, like a fastest thing. So he's on the ground. This is true, this is all true. Terrible, terrible thing. He's on the ground, and he's like, and he says, Spot. Somebody says, Charlie. He says, what? Boom. The dog, this is a true story. The dog hit him, right, knocked him out. The dog would go, oh, whoa. This was a live show then in those days. God, it was terrible. But it's true. It's all true.
Well, in Hollywood now, you're the man. You're the man in charge. I mean, you are at the top, and Schwarzenegger is just passing through.
Yes, right? Of course.
But there was a time, you know.
We beat him in World War I and II. We'll beat him again. I'm not afraid.
There was a time when you were starting off in Hollywood. You know, and there you were sort of green and on the make and everything. Yeah. What was Hollywood like when you were first there?
It was thrilling. I came out there. I was about 23 years old. I got a job writing a screenplay for a guy by the name of Marvin Schwartz. May the Schwartz be with you. This is all true. I was working at Universal in a little bungalow. One day, I'm thinking of ideas. It was called Marriage is a Dirty Rotten Fraud. I swear to you, that was the name of it. And it's still a dirty, rotten fraud. I'll tell you the truth. Second marriage is pretty good. And I'm thinking. A Rolls Royce pulls up. A guy in a double-breasted gray suit, chalk stripe, gets out of the car with a little yellow boot in there. He looks amazingly like Cary Grant. I'm 23 years old. He comes closer and closer and closer. I begin to tremble. I said, Marvin, come. He goes to the window. I said, it's Cary Grant. He said, yes, it's Cary Grant. He has the bungalow next door. I said, what are you crazy, Cary Grant? He's living. I see him. I see Cary Grant. I can't believe it. My heart, Oh, Art. Beats, please, do not fail me. All right. He goes into Grand Art. That's the name of his building. Next day, 12:05, same time, Rolls Royce pulls up. Door opens, blue suit, sharp pinstripes, tiny little red boot in there. It's Cary Grant. This time, I'm ready. I got the camera, 35 millimeter. He gets near his office. Click! I got Cary Grant. Okay. All right. Then I leave. I'm going to lunch. I walk down the steps. I can't believe this. Behind me, I hear. And I had just made a record with Carl Reiner called The 2,000-Year-Old Man. This is a famous record, and it just come out. I'm walking down the steps, and I hear, "Well, I can't believe it. It's Mel Brooks. Mel Brooks, is that you?" I said, oh, my God, it's Cary Grant. He's talking to me. I heard my name. He said, "Mel Brooks." I turned around. I said, "You're Cary Grant." He said, "Yes." I said, "You shouldn't talk to me. I'm nothing. I'm a figment of your imagination. You're a great big star. I'm a little Jew from Brooklyn. Don't even look at me." He said, "I've spent $1,000 yesterday buying your record. I've spent your records to all my friends. It's the funniest damn record I've ever heard in my life. I can't blow it." I said, "Oh, I don't believe this." He said, "Where are you going?" I said, "I'm going to the commissary." That's the lunchroom. The commissary. He said, "Okay, come on. I'll buy you lunch." I said, "Oh, right, Cary Grant." So we go to the commissary together. I walk past the guy, my friend Murray. I said, "Murray, me and Cary are going to lunch." So we go to lunch. Cary Grant, he orders a boiled egg. Don't ask me why. Toast, dry toast and a boiled egg. I order a tuna fish sandwich. What's your favorite color? Yellow. What's your favorite color? Blue. Okay, fine. Great. Finish lunch. We go back. He goes to Grand Art. I go to Schwartz. Go into the bungalow. Everything is gone. Next day, ring. Is Mel Brooks there? Yeah, he's there. It's Cary Grant. It's Cary Grant for me. Right. Will you go to lunch? Yes, Cary. I'll meet you out just outside. Okay, buddy. Yeah, get back. Right. We go to lunch. Cary Grant, I'm walking on. How you doing? What's your favorite car? Rolls Royce? Well, I like a 38 Buick. Okay, fine. Well, you like double-breasted? I like single-breasted, yeah. I like a red tie, you like a blue tie. Isn't that great? I love your hair. You like my hair? Great. Okay, we go in. He has a boiled egg. I have a tuna fish sandwich. We finish lunch. Go back. He goes to Grand Art. I go back to Marvin Schwartz's office. Fine. Next day, ring. Mel, Cam. Now, this time, by this time, we meet outside. We're skipping to the lunch. And the conversation is getting sparse. I don't really know what to say anymore at lunch. I'm getting a little worried. He's just voluble. He's carrying on. He's crazy about me. I don't know what to say. Okay. The next day, Friday, the phone rings. Hello, it's Mel Brooks. I said, if it's Cary Grant, I'm not in.
Well, it's been more than a pleasure. It's been a panic, but we've run out of time. I have to say thank you very much, Mel Brooks. We have to stop there because we've just heard from our crack film research team working in the Ferdinand and Imelda Marcos archive in Zurich that they've uncovered rare footage of some of Imelda's vocal performances during her great days as the benefactors of her people. Yes, not only did she look after their money, she also sang to them, and some of them never got over it. Now we can all share in the beauty of Imelda's unique voice as we say good night from London, come in, Zurich, and sing your heart out, Imelda Marcos.